Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. From time to time, we hear in the news about people that want to help other people in need by providing certain special services. These services may include counseling, health care, housing. Most people are very supportive and agree that helping people in this way is extremely important. Most people applaud those people who are willing to serve their fellow man in such a compassionate way. That is until they hear the counseling service is for criminals. That until they hear the clinic is a methadone clinic for heroin addicts. That is until they hear that the halfway house will be for the mentally challenged and it's going to be built right next door to their own home or in their own block. What was so right to do before seems very wrong to people at this point. What was once a good idea is now rejected, because it's taking place right next door. Who knows why people feel this way? Perhaps they feel fear for their children. They don't want them exposed to such people. Perhaps they feel they will become victims of crime. Maybe they fear that their property values will go down if it's built in their neighborhood. And that just wouldn't be nice. No matter what the reason, most people, including you and me, are inclined to exclaim, it's a good idea helping people in need, but not in my backyard. In our gospel lesson for today, Jesus faces opposition as he ministers to the people of Galilee. There he's delivering people from the opposition of evil. He healed everyone that came to him. Jesus was proclaiming God's grace to repentant sinners, deliverance from evil, healing, good news. Those are good things, aren't they? Who wouldn't want Jesus around? Still, Jesus was rejected. The Pharisees met him. They tell him that Herod wants to kill him. They tell him to flee for his life. They tell them to leave the region, go. What we know for sure is that they wanted Jesus to do his thing, but not in their backyard. Do it someplace else. In a way, they were saying just to go ahead and build God's kingdom, but not here. In response, Jesus tells them that he is in control. And he made that very emphatic, that he was in control. He continued his ministry of deliverance, healing, and calling those who have sinned home to God. He tells them that he will die, but not at the hand of Herod. He will die at the appointed time, like the prophets said before him, in Jerusalem. There in Jerusalem, on the cross, and in his empty grave, his ministry would find its ultimate goal and completion. Many of God's messengers have been rejected. The prophet Jeremiah, for example, is a case in point. Jeremiah faces the rejection and the wrath of the people. What did he do? He spoke what God had told him to speak. He called sinners to come home. He spoke to God to them, about them, saying, "In vain I have chastened your children, but I've received no correction." He told them to believe in God and not empty rituals that had been stripped of their meaning. He told them to look to God and the Messiah that would come to take their sins away. That was the problem. When you tell people that they are sinners, they don't want to hear it. That's not in their ear listening mode. When you tell them that what they're doing isn't right in the eyes of God, you incur their wrath. Jeremiah did incur their wrath, and he was killed. Just as Jeremiah was rejected, Jesus was rejected as well. Now, it's hard for me to imagine anyone rejecting Jesus. When you consider the miracles he had done, you consider all the good things he was doing at the time preceding his death, but his rejection wasn't based on his ministries. The rejection was based on his message. Just like Jeremiah's rejection, Jesus said, "Turn from wickedness and sin. Cry out for God's mercy. Believe in the salvation God alone can give." Jesus says, "Believe in me. I am one that the prophets spoke about. I am the Messiah that has come to be sacrificed. One sacrifice for all people. I am the Messiah that has come." The Pharisees didn't want to hear about what Jesus was saying. They wanted to do things the way they had always done them, trying to please God on their own terms with empty deeds and rituals. As the prophets were, as Jesus was, now we as his body on earth, his holy church, we may also be rejected. If we don't present a happy message, we may be rejected. If we say that there are injustices in the world, racism or sexual inequality, in this country, in this world, and even in some churches, things that are detestable in the sight of the Lord, we may be rejected. When we say that Jesus alone is the Savior of the world, we may be rejected. But in spite of this rejection, we must remain faithful to God's word and our calling to faithfully proclaim it, just as Jeremiah did and just as Jesus did. In the midst of this rejection, we can be confident that our Lord is in control. When Jesus faced the opposition from the Pharisees, he told them that he would continue doing what he was doing. and he knew it would be a three-day process. Our changeless God and his power remain the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. We can be confident that nothing will get in the way of his involvement in our lives. Herod couldn't stop Jesus. The Pharisees couldn't scare him. Jesus is just as in control today as he was then. In control and with determination, Jesus gives deliverance and healing to all that come to him. Jesus tells the Pharisees that he casts out demons. What he says, he's trying to create victory over evil. It would be a victory that would be completed when he rose from the dead. That crown and victory was handed to us. We are confident that he is determined to continue protecting us in life as we face evil and temptation. We also know that he forgives us as his dear children when we don't quite succeed or sometimes totally fail. Jesus not only reigns victorious over evil, he alone is the power to heal. He told the Pharisees, look, I will perform cures today, tomorrow, and the next day. That's the way it is. Jesus came not only to conquer the conquering victor, he came to heal that which was diseased. He came to heal and to restore the world that had been inflicted with sin. For that healing to take place, Jesus had to go to the cross and die. That is why he says, I must journey to Jerusalem. Jesus, looking toward Jerusalem, says, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings. What a picture or scenario that paints for us. All we can see is a mother bird running after her chicks as tragically, and tragedy is about to befall them. Persistently, it chases after them and calls them. God persistently called out to Jerusalem over and over again. He sent the prophet to warn her, to protect her. The city whose name means peace rejected the peace that God offered to it by his prophets. From the city where peace should have flowed out to the world, only the blood of the prophet flowed. Then the Prince of Peace, Jesus himself, came for her and wept for her. He tried to protect her as a hen protects her chicks with his own body from the judgment that would come. But they were not willing. Their house was made a desert, uninhabitable. Jesus persistently called sinners to himself. He persistently calls to us now. Like the Pharisees, we were once inclined to reject Jesus. We were inclined to tell Jesus not to interfere with our lives. There may be a part of us that still does. He persistently bids us to come underneath his wing. He wants to protect us from ourselves by offering us forgiveness. He wants us to come underneath the shelter of his dead body on the cross where his life was given for us. Indeed, he does protect us. By God's grace, Jesus called us by faith to confess our sins and believe in him as our Savior. He has gathered us underneath his wings at the foot of the cross. At the cross, we cannot be harmed. At the cross, we are delivered from danger. Then as we journey from there to Christ's empty tomb, we have the seat and the promise that we have been delivered from evil and healed, both physically and spiritually. During this Lenten season, as we reflect on what Jesus has done for us, We journey with him to Jerusalem. We huddle underneath the cross, where the wings of God, Christ himself, are stretched out to protect us. There at the cross, may we pray together the words of the psalm. Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me. For my soul's trust in you, and in the shadow of the wings, I will make my refuge. As we journey to the empty tomb, may we say, just like the other psalmist, because thou hast been my help, therefore in the shadow of thy wing will I rejoice. During this Lenten season, we should not only reflect on what Jesus did for us, but what we can do in the name of Jesus to offer social justice in today's world, whether it be in the area of healthcare, sexual inequality, racism, bullying, violence, abuse, immigration, or other social areas. The United Methodist Church has a long history of concern for social justice, but it's not really the General Conference, and I don't mean to put them down, that constitutes the church. It is us, the Methodist Christians who follow Jesus. We are the real church, and what will we be willing to do for the world in Jesus' name, even if it is in our own backyard? We know what Jesus did for us. The question is, what will we do to say thank you for his ultimate sacrifice for us? Amen.